As far as I know, every civilization that has experienced prosperity has had a decline in population. There may be a few exceptions. Perhaps people can enlighten me. I'll look at this, the comments on this interview to see perhaps what I can learn. But it seems that from what I've read, every or almost every civilization, when they become prosperous, their birth rate drops.
What happens to civilizations when they become prosperous? Do they inevitably face decline due to hedonism and a drop in birth rates? In this thought-provoking conversation, Jordan Peterson and Elon Musk explore these pressing questions, delving into historical patterns and personal insights. Jordan Peterson and Elon Musk discuss the apparent trend of prosperous civilizations experiencing a decline in birth rates. Musk observes that almost every civilization that has attained prosperity has faced this issue, asking viewers to share any exceptions they know of. Peterson wonders if this decline is a result of a hedonistic egocentrism, which Musk agrees, noting that wealth allows societies to indulge in hedonism without immediate consequences.
You think that's a consequence of the emergence of something like a non-punished hedonistic egocentrism?
There's certainly many examples of civilizations that become prosperous. There is generally a trend towards hedonism.
Yeah, well, you can get away with it if you're wealthy, eh? Because the consequences of your foolishness don't smack you on the head instantly.
Precisely. So, if you're a civilization under threat, mm-hmm. like let's say if you take, say, Rome, when they were trying to not get annihilated by Carthage, and they had Hannibal running around marauding Italy, they didn't have time for hedonism.
Right.
Hedonism
right.
is not an option. We're going to get destroyed by Hannibal.
The chips are down.
And
yeah.
When a civilization is under stress, there's very little hedonism that takes place.
So, William James said that the modern world needed a moral equivalent to war, right? He investigated the religious realm mm-hmm. very, very deeply. And this, I think this was in the Varieties of Religious Experience. And that really had an effect on me because I think that you need something akin to an existential threat in order to set you straight.
I think there's some truth to that.
Yeah.
It's sort of like if it's a spoiled child that where everything that kid gets everything he or she wants, and you have sort of a Veruca Salt situation.
Yeah, right. And
then writ large, that is a civilization that is
prosperous
and where people get everything they want.
I think it's the right way to think about it developmentally and neuropsychologically, because maturation itself consists of two processes, let's say. The more mature I am, the more I'm bringing other people into the purview of my vision. So I extend myself across other people, be my family first, mm-hmm. but then brought more the community more broadly.
Sure.
The better you are at that, the more people you can play a game with at the same time. But you also do the same thing with the future. And that's actually, as far as I can tell, what the cortex is for. It's to move you away from primordial hedonistic motivation to this more inclusive sense of future and community, right? And that's
right.
a higher order self.
Yeah.
And so the default would be immaturity, and wealth can obviously facilitate that. And maybe it's partly because, okay, so you're a very wealthy man. You could give your children anything they ever asked for. Okay, so why not do it? Why not every time they ask for something, why not just deliver it?
There's some wisdom that comes through the ages that you don't want to have someone be a spoiled brat.
And why do you think giving people everything they want exactly when they want it necessarily produces that? Because it seems to.
I think it almost always is.
Okay, you had a rough childhood.
Yeah.
Yeah, like rough and tumble rough childhood. Plenty of fights and a father who was a difficult creature to contend with. Okay, what did that do for you? And are you grateful for it or are you unhappy about it?
Well, I guess you never know the things that really made you who you are today. So at the end of the day, am I on net grateful for my life? I am. And perhaps even for the hard things, because those hard things, I learned from them.
What did you learn? I mean, I read your biography.
It's not an autobiography.
No, it's not. No, no. No, definitely not.
I would tell it in a different way than Isaacson, because Isaacson, who I think is an excellent biographer, is nonetheless looking at things through his lens and wasn't there at the time.
Right, of course, of course. Well, one of the things that stood out for me, too, though, from that, and I would like your comments about this, was the rather... the rough details of your childhood. A lot of physical altercations and a lot of, I don't know exactly how to care.
Physical altercations. I mean, I was almost beaten to death within an inch of my life at one point.
Right, that counts.
Yeah.
That definitely counts as a
physical
altercation.
It wasn't just a few blows here and there, yeah.
If you enjoyed today's video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up and share your thoughts in the comments below. Make sure to subscribe and click the notification bell so you never miss out on our latest content.